In this video, we're going to run through some essential tips to get you started in Oblivion. We'll cover the basics of character creation, including class choice, attributes, and skills, as well as some of the things that you're going to want to do early in the game in order to get the best start. We'll then move on to some easy money-making techniques and a whole bunch of other stuff that you could quite easily miss. So let's start with some tips on character creation and leveling. The first choice that you're going to be offered is to pick your birth sign. I'd recommend picking one of the birth signs that offer a flat attribute increase for your first playthrough. A good example is the Thief, which provides a bonus to your agility, speed, and luck attributes, or the Warrior, which provides a bonus to your endurance and strength. A lot of the others are a bit gimmicky and can get you into hot water. For example, taking 100% increased spell damage if you pick the Apprentice, which I just don't feel is a very good trade-off and can actually make some encounters really difficult and unenjoyable for a new player in particular. There are no doubt niche uses for some of these stranger birth signs, but I wouldn't bother with them as a beginner. Just go with a flat attribute increases. Next up, you're going to be asked to pick your class. The NPCs can have a guess, but it's unlikely to bear any real relevance to what you actually want to do. There are basically three components to your class choice. Firstly, each class has two favored attributes, which simply means you start with +5 to each of these attributes. Long term, this isn't massive, but it can be quite impactful early on, especially if you align it with your birth sign. For example, the Thief birth sign aligns nicely with the Thief class. I know they have the same name, which is a little confusing. But the idea is that both of these choices grant bonuses to agility and speed, which is going to be a nice benefit early on in the game, providing you want to use agility and speed, of course. The second component of your class is your specialization. Every one of the pre-made classes that you see sits under one of the three specs, and if you want to see them in more detail, you can actually view them by clicking Create a Custom Class. Specs basically give a +10 bonus to the skills you see listed, as well as allowing those specific skills to level up faster. And that brings us neatly to the third and final component of your class, skills. Basically, every class will get 7 major skills, and in addition to this, all classes have access to every remaining skill as a minor skill. Essentially meaning that whatever character you make, whatever class you pick, you're always going to have access to every skill in the game. Your major skills will be assigned based on the predefined class you pick, or you can pick them yourself if you're going to create a custom class. This brings us on to efficient leveling. Now, don't get me wrong, you don't need to optimize leveling in Oblivion. It's very far from being a requirement and it's not going to stop you from completing the game. However, if you're an RPG player, you probably do appreciate finding some efficiencies in the process like I do. Now, the way that leveling works in Oblivion is slightly interesting and a little different to some other games. Basically, leveling your major skills is what's going to in turn level your character. If you gain 10 points in your major skills, your character will get 1 level, and your skills are leveled simply by using them. Now, it's worth noting that points gained in minor skills aren't going to level your character. That's the simple part. However, if you gain a certain number of points from the same skill, be it major or minor, you're actually going to get a bonus when you level up. So that's the plus point sign you can see here. Essentially, if you gain 10 points from the same major skill, you're going to get +5 to the governing attribute of that particular skill. And +5 is the maximum bonus possible, by the way. So, for example, if you have the Marksman major skill, and you gain 10 points in this skill during the same level, essentially from using your bow, then you're going to gain a +5 bonus to agility when you level up, providing you pick the agility attribute to level up in this screen that I'm showing now. Now, this is because agility is the governing attribute for the Marksman major skill. This is basically the concept that underpins the most efficient forms of leveling. You can actually get really efficient and overcap skill points before you level up in order to get the highest possible attribute bonus every single level. This would mean getting +5 in all three areas that you're able to spend your points in when you level up. And to do this, you'd actually have to hold off on spending your level until you'd gained 30 major skill points rather than the standard 10 that's required to trigger the level in the first place. The reason you can do this is that you won't actually level up even after you've got the 10 skill points unless you go to sleep. So you just wait to go to sleep until you've got 30 major skill points, 10 in each of the areas that you'd like to level up. It gets a bit confusing and I'm not going to delve into the detail here, but if you want to Google efficient leveling in Oblivion, some people have got really deep into it. Again, to emphasize, efficient leveling is in no way essential to complete any content in Oblivion. It's just nice to understand the basics of how leveling works, and it's up to you how efficient you want to get with it. Just to round out this bit on character creation, I want to point out again that increasing your minor skills will not level your character. However, they will contribute towards the bonus attribute points that you get when your character does level. And for this reason, they can be used as part of an efficient leveling system. Oh yeah, and make sure you create a save file before you leave the sewers. The reason for doing this is the last point at which you can make changes to your character, and it's going to basically allow you to create new characters without having to complete the whole tutorial each time. I appreciate that this can all be a little confusing, as the Oblivion class systems are fairly complex when compared to a lot of other games. So I definitely suggest re-watching this first section if you really want to cement it. Once again, don't obsess too much though, because Oblivion isn't really that hard of a game, and you really don't need to min-max everything to complete it. So at this point, you've created your character, escaped the prison, and brushed as much sewage off yourself as possible. Now you're faced with an open world of endless possibility. So, what should you do first? Well, that's the beauty of Elder Scrolls games. You can basically do whatever the hell you want. But there are definitely a few things that are worth doing early on, so let's take a look at them. One of the very first things I'd suggest doing is heading to the Imperial City Arena District and signing up to fight there. It's very simple, you just need to have a conversation with a guy called Owen, or Owine, in the Bloodworks. He'll give you your fighter's raiment and send you straight in for your first fight. That's providing you're there between 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. as fights don't happen outside of these times. Why bother with this? Well, beating up on people in the arena is fun, but it also rewards gold for every victory, and this goes up over time, eventually reaching 500 gold per victory. The fights are really short, so this is actually a pretty efficient way of getting a few coins in your purse early on. It's also a nice way to increase your combat skills, so you know, weapon skills, armor skills, magic, etc. And all of this combined just makes the arena a really good thing to do early on. Another one to join early is the Dark Brotherhood. This is useful for a number of reasons. Firstly, the quests are awesome and I'd encourage you to join it regardless. But in more practical terms, you'll be given some decent gold rewards for completing contracts, as well as being given a set of armor the moment you join. And that armor is actually pretty good, especially if you're going for a sneaky assassin type build. It gives a bonus to sneak, marksmanship, blades, as well as illusion and acrobatics. It's pretty spicy considering how easy it is to get. Joining the Dark Brotherhood does involve a few steps, so it's not quite as simple as joining the arena, but I have created a video that outlines those steps in details, as well as the steps to join all of the other guilds in the game, so I'll link that in the description down below. In fact, whilst we're at it, let's talk about some of the other guilds as well. I definitely recommend joining the Thieves Guild early on, purely for access to a fence. A fence is basically someone who's going to allow you to sell stolen goods, which is an easy way to make some money early on. We'll talk a bit more about easy money making in some of the later tips. It's also worth joining the Mages Guild, and this is primarily to get started on the steps you need to take to unlock spellmaking at the Arcane University. Basically, there's a system in Oblivion that lets you make your own spells, and if this is something you want to utilize throughout the game, then it's best to start the Mages Guild questline early on, so that way you can unlock spellmaking and start to enjoy it sooner. Moving on from the various guilds, another thing to start doing as soon as possible is equipping both light and heavy armor. The reason for this is that by equipping both types of armor, you'll gain skill points for both. Simple, but useful. Another efficiency-based tip is to get a horse as soon as you can. It's just going to make it way quicker for you to get around. If you bought Oblivion from Steam, then you might actually have a bunch of DLC included, and one of those might be the Horse Armor Pack. If you have that, you can just go to the stables outside the Imperial City, I think it's called Chestnut Handy Stables, and you'll be able to get your first horse there for free. If you don't have that, the cheapest horse you can buy is available for 500 gold at the Wild Eye Stables in Bruma, or the Five Riders Stables in Leowyn. You can also steal horses, but there are a bunch of disadvantages to doing this, so I'd suggest you look this up at least before you decide to steal one. I'd also suggest getting hold of a player house as early as possible. The primary reason for this is that they offer permanent storage for your items. There's only a certain amount of items that you can carry in your inventory, and there are plenty of items that you're going to come across that you want to keep hold of rather than flog to a vendor. As with the horse armor, you may find that you already have a bunch of DLC from Steam. If so, you'll have several player houses that can be unlocked for free via quests, and they'll automatically be given to you early in the game. I believe you get a quest the second you leave the sewers if you've got this DLC. Otherwise, you can simply buy the cheapest player house, which is the Waterfront Shack that you can buy from the Office of Imperial Commerce. And that office is located in the Market District of the Imperial City. It'll cost you 2,000 gold, and I think you might actually need to use the persuasion wheel, more on that later, to persuade the vendor to sell you it. Once you own the shack, you can upgrade it by purchasing furnishings from the Free Brothers Trade Goods. Again, this is found in the Market District of the Imperial City. If you want to get that horse and player house early on, especially if you don't have the DLC, then you're going to need some gold. We already talked about the Arena and the Dark Brotherhood, but here are a few other ways for making money early on. The absolute easiest way to make a quick buck early on is to join the Mages and Warriors Guilds. Again, see my video in the description on how to join the various guilds. What you're going to do after you join them is sell their stuff. Basically, once you join either of these two guilds, the majority of the stuff within those guilds becomes yours to loot. Then you can very simply sell it. In fact, you can even sell it in the same building in some cases, as you can see from the example on screen. Also, there are guilds in most cities, so this can be replicated for every guild you visit. It's not mega money, but it's a hell of an easy way to get money in the early stages of the game. Of course, you don't necessarily need to get permission to take people's goods in Oblivion. You could always just steal it and then sell it to a fence. A particularly good place to do this is the Imperial City Market District, where you can essentially break into the shops at night and rinse them for what they're worth. On that note, it makes sense to target items with a good weight to value ratio. Items such as jewelry, potions, ingredients, books, spell tomes, these are all a good place to start. So look for the shops that sell these items when stealing. The reason I've made this a separate point from stealing, however, is because this concept applies across the board, and it's just going to help you better organise your inventory in general. Alchemy is also another really good way to make gold in Oblivion, actually arguably the best way. A good trick early on is just to take low-value food items and turn them into potions in order to sell at a profit. Food is found all over the place in-game, and you can also steal it. And in fact, if you do steal food, it effectively fences it by turning it into a potion, as the output potion isn't considered to have been stolen. I have a video that goes into more detail on this and gives some specific examples of where to start, so I'll link that in the description down below as well. Now, the final section of tips is what I guess you could call miscellaneous, and this is mostly because they don't fit into one obvious category, but some of the stuff in here is absolutely vital, so do stick around. I'll try to make this a bit more quickfire than the previous sections as well. Firstly, make sure you speak to everyone. Sounds obvious, but there really isn't one linear path in Oblivion, and you never know what people might have for you. It's genuinely useful stuff, and it can often lead to really cool adventures, so just speak to everyone you see. Next up, weapon charges. Basically, some weapons will have a magical enchantment, and can carry a certain number of charges until that weapon will need recharging. The weapon charges are quite expensive early on in the game, so I'd ration these charges for the harder fights early on when you're poor. When it comes to finding these fancy weapons, be sure to pay extra attention to loot found in Oblivion Gates. I'd suggest going out of your way to loot everything you can during these encounters, as there's some really great stuff in them, especially as you reach the higher levels. These weird little egg sacks that you see all over the place can actually hold some really powerful stuff, so make sure you loot them. Repairs are also important in Oblivion. It's not like other games where you can wait until your gear is at 1% and then repair it. Your kit actually becomes less efficient as it's damaged, so either go to a vendor and repair frequently, or remember to carry repair hammers in your inventory to repair on the go. Another thing worth knowing is that there's a persuasion wheel in-game that pops up every time you speak to NPCs. Like I said before, weapon charges and repairs will cost gold, and if you have a good disposition with a vendor, you can save a little bit of money by haggling the price down. It's also vital in unlocking certain dialogue and NPCs in order to progress quests. Seems simple, but again, you could easily miss it. A whole bunch of the stuff we've just talked about involves accessing towns and cities, and if you want to be able to get into the city to do that kind of thing easily, then remember that infamy will have consequences. If you decide to just murder everyone, then the guards will become hostile, and this is going to make it very difficult to access places and progress various activities. I'm not saying don't do it, just know that it could cause you some problems. Another one that might seem obvious, but I want to say it anyway, is enemy scaling. Basically, enemies will scale as your character levels up. They'll not only become stronger, but as you level up, new types of enemies will start to appear. You can always adjust the difficulty slider in your settings if you're struggling or finding this too easy. Speaking of enemies, certain enemies won't take any damage at all from certain weapons. For example, when you attempt to hit certain ghosts in-game with a normal physical weapon, they're going to be totally immune to it. These enemies may require a magical weapon or the use of a particular school of magic to defeat. Sometimes this is essential to do any damage at all, and other times it's just that the enemy has a particular resistance or weakness to something. One example is vampires, who have a resistance to normal weapons, but take greatly increased damage from fire spells. There are many more examples like this. And finally, speaking of vampires, you can actually become one yourself in Oblivion. This will grant you some powerful abilities and stat increases, but you're also going to suffer some consequences. There's a fair bit to this topic, and again, I have a video that talks about this specifically, so I'll link that in the description down below along with the others. And that just about does it. That really did end up longer than I expected, but I hope you found the tips useful. If you did, then please consider liking the video and subscribing for future content, and yeah, see you next time.